joy it is for me and Pat to be with you all this morning on this rainy day. Praise the Lord. During my junior high years, growing up in Houston, I went to St. Mark's Episcopal Church, just west of the medical center. And when I was in junior high school, I went to Sunday school class one Sunday in early spring. And I sat down, I got there a little early, and the person next to me, after I sat down, kind of punched me, and he said, the bishop's coming next Sunday for confirmation. I said, oh, good. And a few minutes later, before class started, he punched me, and he said, hey, Rayford, you want to be confirmed? I said, sure. So I showed up next Sunday and sat with my class, and the bishop came in. We went up to the rail. The bishop came by each one of us and and the bishop left, and I was confirmed. And of course, some of y'all may notice there was something that wasn't quite right with that story. I didn't go to class. And I'm not going to comment on look what it, you know, turned out to be. But the service of confirmation that I participated in was the 1928 Book of Common Prayer. And in the minds of many, many people, going back hundreds of years, confirmation was the completion of baptism. It was the final stage for a member to become a person to become a member of the Episcopal Church and of the Christian faith, and have all the rights and privileges thereof. I shared with the class. It was in 1285 that the Archbishop of Canterbury mandated that you could not receive communion until you were confirmed. And that was done only because he had to make the bishops somehow get out of their offices and go do confirmations and visitations. It didn't have anything to do theologically with anything except get those guys out and get them working. So there's a long history to confirmation as we know it today. And I certainly don't want to bore you with its developments. Our 1979 Book of Common Prayer, in my mind, has reached back into antiquity and placed baptism in its proper sacramental place. Baptism is sufficient as full Christian initiation. From the book Signed, Sealed, and Delivered, which has just recently been published, I quote, while baptism fully commissions a person for Christian ministry, every Christian at whatever age baptized must grow into the full stature of Christ, as Ephesians 4 says. For some, there may be a distinctive moment of new maturity and faith when the eyes of one's heart become open to the Spirit in a new way, resulting in a new depth of commitment to God's mission in the world. For these Christians, a ritual expression of their renewed commitment and of God's enabling Spirit, whether through confirmation or reaffirmation of faith, may be very appropriate. Ritual expressions of the Spirit strengthen grace, can remind us of our dependence on God, even as we renew our resolve to lead a Christian life. Close quote. As for those of us who were baptized as infants, confirmation gives us an opportunity to own that commitment and promise that were made by our parents and godparents and to experience the empowering gift of the Spirit in our lives. Well, having said that, I want to turn now just to two final thoughts. First, for me, what is said in the prayer of confirmation is its essence. The prayer that I'm so grateful that we have in our prayer book service is, "Strengthen, O Lord, your servant," and you use the name, "with your Holy Spirit. Empower for your service." There are two action words that are used there about what we are doing. Strengthen and empower. You are strengthened by God's Holy Spirit. You are empowered. You're empowered not to be a better looking, or more smarter, or more better, or more prosperous. No, you are empowered by God's Holy Spirit. Then, through the prayer, the bishop says over you, to serve, period. That's it. Serve God and God's mission and God's people. That's it. To serve, to do ministry, implies something. It implies that you have gifts to serve, gifts for ministry. I firmly believe what we're saying is simply God empowers you and me through the Holy Spirit to use the gifts that God has given you and me. We're all given gifts. As St. Paul reminds us in that first letter to the Corinthians. Let me share with you how that has been lived out in my life. And if some of the young people who are here from last year may remember this story. When I was in junior high school, at Pershing Junior High School in Houston, I was in the choir. No offense to you all, but when I was in the choir, they needed warm male bodies. After the first concert, the teacher came up to me and said, "Rayford, in the next concert we have, I want you to mouth the words." And from that time on, I was aware that maybe that was not a gift that I had, but maybe I could work on it. And I worked for 18 years at St. Paul's Church in Waco under the direction of Dr. Robert Young, the dean of the vocal department at Baylor. And he finally told me, he said, "Rayford, just stand next to me." So that's a gift I don't have. And I finally recognized that. That's why when I go down the aisle, I always have my mic turned off. And then the other thing in high school, another gift that I learned I didn't have is that in my senior year, I put off taking a science before I graduated from high school. And I took chemistry the last year, and I made a D both semesters. And that was a gift from the teacher. That is actually a gift I do not have. But God has given me other gifts. I have done a lot of visiting and seeing people who have had a great loss and are in a great deal of pain and suffering. And I feel compelled to call on them. And I feel able to do that and just to be with them. Not everybody can do that, and not everybody should do that. But that's a gift God has given me. God has also given me a gift to go into men's prisons and women's prisons to bring Christ's love and forgiveness and acceptance to those men and women. A number of people I've talked to about doing prison ministry said, I can't do that. I can't go in. I can. That's a gift God's given me. What gifts has God given you for ministry? What gifts has God given you for ministry? I don't care how old you are, but think about what your gifts are. Talk to your clergy or your sponsor and see how those gifts can be used in and through Trinity for God's mission and God's work and ministry. One final thought. We're not alone in this new ministry that you're undertaking. We are all going to join you, the class, as we reaffirm our baptismal vows through that baptismal covenant. We will state what we believe in God, the triune God, how we respond to God, and how we treat our fellow human beings as followers of Jesus. Now you will soon be empowered by God's Spirit to serve Christ and Christ's church. And to all of y'all, now, get out of the world and go to work. Amen.
Amen.